Hello everyone, this is Dr. Sam and this video is about shoulder ultrasound. We start off by scanning the supraspinatus tendon. This is in transverse view. We see a normal supraspinatus tendon. And up here is the deltoid muscle. This hyperechoic layer is the peribursal fat. This hypoechoic or anechoic region is the articular cartilage. And this hyperechoic curved structure is the humeral head. This is a case of supraspinatus tendinosis. In this condition, we will find hypoechoic areas in the supraspinatus tendon. In some cases of tendinosis, we may find calcifications. We see hyperechoic calcifications within the supraspinatus tendon. Here is a longitudinal view of the supraspinatus tendon. We can see the normal fibrillar structure, which are alternating hyperechoic and hypoechoic lines, which are often found in tendons and muscles. And over here, in the case of tendinosis, we will find heterogeneous areas, and also there is loss of normal fibrillar echo texture. This is a case of full thickness supraspinatus tear. In a full thickness tear, we will find an anechoic area of discontinuity that will involve the entire thickness of the tendon. When we see this anechoic area, which involves the full thickness of the tendon, we can call it a full thickness tear. Here is another image of a full thickness tear. We can see a large anechoic area extending from the bursal side of the tendon all the way to the articular side. This upper side is the bursal side because it is next to the subacromial bursa, and the one that is near to the humeral head is the articular side. This is a partial thickness supraspinatus tear. We see anechoic area of discontinuity that involves only one side of the tendon. It does not go all the way through the whole thickness of the tendon. So this is a partial thickness tear. Here is another image of a partial thickness tear. Here it is a bursal side tear because it is seen at the anterior aspect of the supraspinatus tendon. This anterior side of the tendon is called the bursal side. This right here is the subacromial bursa. So this side is right next to the bursa, hence it is known as the bursal side. This is a partial thickness supraspinatus tear at the articular side. This articular side is right next to the humerus. So this part of the tendon is known as the articular side. And this is the partial thickness tear. This is an intrasubstance tear. It occurs near the greater tuberosity of the humerus. It does not involve the bursal side nor the articular side of the supraspinatus tendon. This small bulging area on the greater tuberosity of the humerus is called the insertional foot plate of supraspinatus. The supraspinatus tendon attaches here. Any tear seen at this location is called a rim rent tear. This is the tear at the insertional foot plate on the greater tuberosity. It is also a type of partial thickness tear. A cartilage interface sign can sometimes occur in case of a supraspinatus tear. Normally we see the hypoechoic or anechoic articular cartilage in this manner. But when there is a tear, this interface between the normal cartilage and the tear becomes hyperechoic due to enhancement because of the tear right next to the cartilage, and this can form a hyperechoic line between the tear and the normal appearing hypoechoic cartilage. It does not always occur, but this can indicate a supraspinatus tear when it is seen. A normal subacromial bursa appears as a thin hypoechoic line between the deltoid muscle and the supraspinatus tendon. And here we have subacromial bursitis. There is increased amount of fluid in the bursa. Also, there will be increased bursal wall thickening. Here is another image of subacromial bursitis. We see a very large amount of fluid within the bursa. Calcific tendinitis can occur in the supraspinatus tendon. In this case, we will find a hyperechoic calcification with posterior shadowing within the supraspinatus tendon. Here is an image of a normal biceps tendon in transverse view. More specifically, it is the long head of biceps tendon. It looks like a round hyperechoic structure, and this is the humerus. And over here is the subscapularis tendon. This is the lesser tuberosity. And up here is the deltoid muscle. Biceps tenosynovitis is the inflammation of the biceps tendon sheath. In this condition, we will find increased fluid within the tendon sheath. Here is another image of tenosynovitis. We see a large amount of fluid within the biceps tendon sheath. Here we see the normal biceps tendon in longitudinal view. This is the tendon. And over here we see tenosynovitis in longitudinal view as well. We see some amount of fluid within the tendon sheath. Here is an image of a biceps tendon tear. It looks similar to that of tenosynovitis. We can find a hypoechoic tear within the tendon. And also there will be increased fluid within the tendon sheath. Here is another image of a biceps tendon tear. The torn tendon is completely filled with hypoechoic fluid. This may indicate a complete biceps tendon tear. A biceps tendon rupture can give a Popeye sign, which means there will be a bulging biceps muscle. There will be a large swelling of the biceps muscle. It usually occurs due to a large fluid collection within the tendon sheath. Subluxation means partial dislocation, and in this case there is a bicep tendon subluxation. There is a minor dislocation of the biceps tendon. We may find a partially empty bicipital groove. This is the bicipital groove and it is partially empty because of subluxation of the bicep tendon. This is the biceps tendon. It is slightly dislocated from its original location. Here is a case of biceps tendon dislocation. There is complete displacement of the biceps tendon. It is medially displaced. The bicipital groove is empty. Now we will examine the acromioclavicular joint. On one side we will see the acromion and on the other side we will see the clavicle. And between these two bones is the acromioclavicular ligament. It appears hypoechoic or anechoic. This is the appearance of a normal acromioclavicular joint. And in this image, we have AC joint osteoarthritis. The joint space is filled with hyperechoic osteophyte. Also, there is capsular hypertrophy. We see a thick joint capsule, whereas over here, this type of thickness is not seen. Here is a case of AC joint subluxation or dislocation. The usual feature in these cases is the widening of AC joint space. We can see it is much more wider than in the normal case. This is a case of an AC joint cyst. The cyst usually communicates with the acromioclavicular joint. This type of appearance is known as the Geyser sign. Usually this AC joint cyst is associated with rotator cuff tears. This image shows us the glenohumeral joint. This is the glenoid, which is the lateral part of the scapula where the humeral head attaches. This is the humerus. And over here we have glenohumeral joint effusion. There is accumulation of fluid in the glenohumeral joint. Ultrasound is usually not performed for shoulder dislocations, but they can still be seen. This is a case of an anterior shoulder dislocation. Mainly we will see joint effusion and a large gap between the humeral head and the scapula. The humeral head is displaced anteriorly. The scapula can be seen up here and the humeral head will be seen down here in the image. This is an image of posterior shoulder dislocation. The scapula is seen below the humeral head in this image. The humeral head has been displaced posteriorly and it will show higher up in the image. It will be higher than the scapula. This is a case of frozen shoulder, which is also known as adhesive capsulitis. On ultrasound, it may appear normal, and in some cases, fluid accumulation in the biceps tendon sheath will be seen. The features are then correlated clinically. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe and stay tuned for more imaging videos.